Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
The Alamance County Board of Commissioners is now in session. I'd like to call on Commissioner Massey, who will lead us in our invocation and afterwards the Pledge of Allegiance.
Awesome. Let's bow our heads, please. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for that we have this ability that we can come and do the business of Alamance County. And we just pray that we can do what is right and best for the citizens of Alamance County. And thank you for everything that you do for us. Amen.
Amen. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Welcome, everybody, and if you have any cell phones, please turn them off at this time. Before we get into the agenda, I'd like to call on Commissioner Emeritus Sam Powell. Commissioner?
Chairman Smith and Commissioners, I come before you tonight as a representative from the Friends of Alamance Battleground. It's a support group for our battleground here in Alamance County. It's with sad news that I'd let you know tonight that Brian Dalton is planning to retire. He has announced his intentions to retire on November the 1st. So we would like to honor him. And tonight I'm bringing forward a proclamation to proclaim Monday, November the 3rd, 2014, Brian Dalton Day in Alamance County. And I'd like to read the proclamation, if that's all right.
Yes, please.
Whereas the 1771 Battle of Alamance, in which a massed body of regulators were defeated by the North Carolina militia near Alamance Creek, is significant to the identity of Alamance County. And whereas in 1880, citizens of Alamance County raised funds that resulted in the erection of a marker commemorating the event and in the organization of a company to obtain a portion of the battle site, and whereas the North Carolina General Assembly in 1909 chartered the Alamance Battleground Company to better identify and protect the site for posterity, and whereas the battleground in 1939 became one of the first sites to be awarded a state highway historical marker, and whereas in 1952 Alamance County Commissioners deeded a 40-acre tract to the state to be developed as a historic site, and in 1955 responsibility for the site was transferred to the Department of Archives and History, now the Department of Cultural Resources, which opened the historic site to the public on May the 16th, 1961. And whereas Brian Dalton has dedicated 36 years to Alamance Battleground State Historic Site, beginning in 1978 with an Elon College History internship and becoming site manager in 1984. And whereas the historic site has been enlarged to 60.2 acres during Brian Dalton's three decades as site manager, and whereas Brian Dalton's leadership has supported a stable and energetic staff whose creativity produces a variety of year-round experiences to engage all ages, and whereas approximately 60,000 public, private, and homeschooled students drawn from many counties have participated in the state's annual Colonial Living Week under his management, and whereas Brian Dalton's vision of history as integral to the community and culture has attracted groups and individuals to mutually beneficial undertakings, and whereas Brian Dalton coordinated a Constitution Bicentennial Program for Alamance County in 1987, and was project manager for the Alamance County Bicentennial Committee in 1988. And whereas in 2009 through 10, Brian Dalton directed logistical support and provided local expertise for the Alamance Battleground Research Project, whose archaeological discoveries are currently exhibited at Alamance Battleground State Historic Site, and whereas the project's discoveries provided physical illustrations of the battleground's role during the Revolutionary War and the Civil War, in addition to the Regulator Movement, and whereas Alamance Battleground is a travel destination and tour programs of nationwide interest, including Civil War trails and the American Revolution Southern Campaign. And whereas Alamance Battleground State Historic Site is a vital economic, cultural, and educational asset of Alamance County, now therefore be it resolved that Monday, November 3rd, 2014, is hereby proclaimed Brian Dalton Day in Alamance County in recognition of his earnest diligence, continuous efforts, and unfailing courtesy in serving the public, and in recognition of his enhancement of the recognition and vitality of Alamance Battleground State Historic Site. Mr. Chairman, I think it would be great if we could adopt this resolution and so honor Mr. Dalton.
Do you have a motion, John?
So moved.
Bill?
Second.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you, Sam.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate it. Let me add that Sam not only was a commissioner, he served on the Alamance Community College Board and is now on the State Community College Board. Proud of you, Sam.
Thank you, sir.
Next item, or the first item on our agenda is our public speakers. We have two, I believe.
he's still here. I don't see him.
Who is it?
Just bypass.
Yeah, Pam?
I've never seen him. I come in peace. I am Pamela Tyra Thompson, and I am one of the seven members of the Board of Education. And I want to thank you guys for giving me just a couple of minutes to speak with you. I am here representing just myself tonight to plant a seed for the future. I want to simply invite the Board of Commissioners to come along with the Board of Education on an ABSS school bus, and together we walk the campuses of some of our schools. I really want you to meet the amazing people within our schools that make a big difference in the lives of our children, every day, every minute, and every hour. Our boards are partners when it comes to the future of Alamance County. I've got you an invitation that I made, and inside of that invitation is Superintendent Dr. Bill Harrison's cell number. He gives it out. he truly is the definition of excellent leadership, and I encourage you to call him and have a discussion about a date in the future that we can do this. There's no money inside of these. I asked my husband
Thank
if
you.
I was committing a crime, and he said no. And for you, Mr. Paisley, and somebody else that would be sitting there, Mr. Sutton, as a citizen of this county and also a public servant, I want to personally thank you for your service. You're going to be missed, and really, God bless you in huge ways. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Pam. Is Tony still here?
I didn't see him when I came in.
He was back in the back. All right, then let's move on. Approval of the any response to Pam from the board?
Just want to say thank you for the job that you guys are doing, Doctor. I wish he was not an interim superintendent. I wish he were the permanent superintendent. He's doing a wonderful job.
He really
Things
is.
Are much improved. Thank you.
He's a blessing.
All right, approval of the agenda. Does anyone have any item they'd like to pull on the agenda? Hearing none, is there a motion to approve the agenda, which includes the consent agenda?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
The public hearing for our Rural Operations Assistant Program. Planning Director.
Yeah. Good evening, Chairman Smith, Board. This public hearing has been requested to allow the public to comment on our current application for Rural Operating Assistance Program funds from the North Carolina Department of Transportation. The programs included in the Rural Operating Assistance Program application are the Elderly and Disabled Transportation Assistance Program for elderly and disabled citizens, the Employment Transportation Assistance Program for persons with employment-related transportation needs, and the Rural General Public Program for public transportation in non-urban areas of the county. The current grant for 2015 will be $263,227, and all required matching funds are generated through rider fares.
Is there a motion to go into a public hearing?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All right, we'll start with those on my right, your left. Anybody on this side of the room want to be heard on this particular matter? Seeing none, my left, your right. Anybody in this part of the building? Do I hear a motion that we close the public hearing?
So moved.
Is there a second? Second. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. You want this passed?
It's just a certification.
Right. The only action we had to take tonight was the
just
public hearing.
Just to have a public hearing?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Good enough. Thank you very much. I'm going to skip the first item and take it a little later. The Alamance County SOAR Employee Award. Mr. Manager?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Board of Commissioners. Tonight, we'd like to recognize our first quarterly Employee SOAR Award winner, Ms. Wendy Burgess. Wendy is a Librarian Assistant 2 at May Memorial. And she was nominated three times, two by the general public and one by her employee, or one by her coworker. And I just want to read a very short paragraph of one of her nominations. Wendy is always courteous to all. She goes beyond her job title with the children and the parents. All of my children love her, and she has been inspired with her garden club classes. She's a huge asset to the library, and that was part of the citizen nomination that she was given. We had a wonderful breakfast on October 3rd. We had 20 nominees that attended for the quarter. Three of them were nominated more than once. Great breakfast. It was a wonderful event, and we're very proud of Wendy and her job. And MJ, do you want to get up and say?
Wendy works in the children's department at May Memorial, and she is just phenomenal with the kids and with the other staff, and she's always willing to go the extra mile. The parents love her, the kids love her. She just does a great job. So I was really excited that she received three nominations, and then on the nominating committee that chose the person, it was a unanimous decision on the part of the nominating committee. So hands down, it's great to have her be our first SOAR County employee.
Wendy, would you like to say anything?
Oh, I'm never short for words.
I have only been here 2.5 years. I love my job. I love the people I work with. I feel like I'm living the dream every day, and I just thank you so much for your support, and I love children, so I hope that I can't see that changing, and I just hope to continue to give give back to our community. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Wendy.
Mr. Chairman, I do want to say, it was a nice breakfast, and Brian and I both read the nominations. This is kind of an offshoot of an employee survey we did, and one of the big things that our employees have wanted is for us to really recognize them, and we really wanted to show value to our employees, and we had some excellent nominations, and very proud of all of those that were nominated, and you do have a list of those in your file or on your agenda packet. I do want to thank our occupational health nurse, Michelle Zeiser, kind of headed up the SOAR committee. MJ also headed up the nomination review. And we will be doing this each quarter. And we would like to, next time we have the breakfast, we'll make sure we invite you to attend.
Thank you.
Congratulations, Wendy, and thank you very much for your service.
Thank you, and I need to go back to work.
You certainly
I apologize.
She'll be nominated again next year.
Thank you so much.
Mr. County Attorney.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I have a report on the sale of the property to Peak of Graham. We closed that sale and received about $3.9 million, less $30.
Wow.
So that money was wired to the county. And in so doing, I've often said that you don't know what you own till you sell it. And we found a corporation that was formed in 1975 to create the Woody Drive property known as County of Alamance NC Healthcare Development Corporation was still in existence. And they were formed to provide a conduit for funding. The county issued bonds. The bonds were paid for by the rents on the property. And all of this came to fruition in 1996, at which time the property was supposed to have been conveyed to Alamance County and the corporation dissolved. That didn't happen. So what I have put before you tonight is a resolution appointing the county manager as president of the corporation and the assistant county manager's secretary, and yours truly as general counsel, and we will...
Can you pay involved in them?
I was getting to that.
What I was afraid of.
No, what we will do, we will have if this resolution passes, we will have a director's meeting tomorrow morning, and we will convey the property to Alamance County and close out the corporation. The paperwork's ready to go, ready to be signed, and all I need is your permission to go forward with that.
Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Passes.
Thank you. The second item is the sale of real property to Ralph Scott Life Services. We have some of those folks with us here tonight. We passed a resolution several meetings back where we were going to give the property to them as long as they used it as a nonprofit. We had a reverter clause in it. They looked at the building and they got in contact with some people to do the repairs and found out that it was a little more money than they expected. So they're going to have to get a bank loan, and banks don't like the reverter clauses. So what I have before you tonight is a provision to sell the property by sealed bid, which is what we did with the O&E building a couple of years back. And I anticipate what they will do is produce a bid and present it to the county manager. Under the statute, we have to advertise this. The ad has already been prepared and ready to go in the paper, pending your approval. We publish in the newspaper 30 days before the bids are to be opened. And anyone can put in a bid. The consideration can be the fact that they provide services to citizens in our community that suffer from mental and physical disabilities. And that has been upheld by the court as valuable consideration. So the bid can be whatever you decide it should be. If they bid $1,000, if they bid $10, if they have a competitive bid, this board can weigh that and give them the property for whatever bid they they put in their sealed bid. We won't know that until we open it up. The O&E building, we got no competitive bids. But the provision also provides that any and all bids may be accepted or rejected by this board.
Your motion?
So moved.
Second?
I second it.
All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you, Clyde.
Thank you.
Mr. Assistant County Manager?
Good evening, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners.
Fine.
I'm here to speak to you tonight about we're working to relocate county departments. As Mr. Albright mentioned just a moment ago, the county received right at $3.9 million in proceeds from the sale of properties. One of those properties that was sold was the building at 217 College Street. There are a number of county functions that take place in that building today. This includes the county's planning department, inspections department, our addressing function, passports, and veteran services. All these departments are housed at 217 College Street. And the deal has been closed. We are no longer the owner of that property. However, they are letting us letting our folks stay there. But demolition of that building has been scheduled to begin February 1, 2015. So we have got to get the county departments and folks out of there pretty quickly. Our target date is to have everyone out, all county employees, staff, and departments out by December 15th. What we're going to be able to go in, our facilities department's going to be able to go in and take as much out of the building as we can use. So we'll be trying to get HVAC units, carpet tiles, ceiling tiles, a number of things we'll be getting out. But that will take a month to a month and a half, and we got to have the employees out before we start doing that. So here are the planned moves. I'm going to give you the dates and the locations. And we will do some press releases for this these moves too, so the public knows where our folks are at and where they can get their services. Veteran Services will be moving from College Street to the Court Services Building at 201 West Elm Street. This is diagonally across the street. They are going to be moving on December 1st and 2nd. The Planning Department will move temporarily to the modular over by Environmental Health. If you're familiar with the blue modular building beside Environmental Health, address is 215 North Graham Hopedale Road, and Planning will be moving on December 1st and 2nd. County Inspections Department and Addressing Function will be moving temporarily to that same modular on December 15th and 16th. So we'll be one day behind, but I think we can live with that. And the Passports Clerk will be moving to May Memorial Library on December 15th, or by December 15th. So we're going to have everyone out of the building right around December 15th. I have to tell you that we are estimating, we have some bids and some estimations, that it will cost approximately $250,000 to pull this move off, to relocate these county departments. What I'm asking you to consider tonight is allocating that $250,000 needed for these relocations from the proceeds of the sale, from the $3.9 million. What we have estimated is as follows. To move the departments, all their equipment, store their files temporarily, replace certain furnitures that we will need is approximately $27,000. The modular building where planning, inspections, and addressing will be locating to renovate that building is approximately $23,000 to host them there. The court services building across the street, this is the largest cost that we're foreseeing. We're estimating $115,000. It's all restroom work almost. The restrooms in that building were not redone during facility improvement. And Brenda indicates to us that many of her clients are disabled. And we've got to make, if they move in that building, we'll have to make those restrooms ADA compliant. And that is our estimate to do that and some other repair work in the building. We have several nonprofit agencies that are located at the Elderly Services Building, which is behind Environmental Health. We have budgeted and estimated approximately $54,000 that we will need to use to relocate them. That is not a certain factor. We may not have to relocate them, but I'd rather ask you to approve those funds now. And if we do not move them, we won't have to spend the money. To move Passports to May Memorial, we're estimating approximately $1,000 in equipment to get her over there and get her in place. And we're also asking you to consider allowing us to budget approximately $30,000 for planning costs. If you'll notice, I said that the moves to the modular for planning and inspections and addressing are temporary. That building is really not a long-term solution, but it's the only place we have right now that those folks could go on this short of notice. What we would like to do is take a look at some of the properties that we own, some of the buildings that we have, that will and get some estimates for either renovation versus possible new construction. We will have to bring in some other people to help us do that, and we think that we can do, get some planning done for approximately $30,000. The total cost estimate then is $250,000. Again, asking you to consider allocating these funds from the $3.9 million that came in from the sale of the properties. And let me reiterate that any of those $250,000, if you allocate it, anything that's not spent will return to the allocated fund pool. So if you have any questions, I'll be happy to try to answer them. Also have Richard Hill here this evening of the Facilities Department, and we'll try to answer any questions that you have.
Any questions for Brian?
Mr. Chairman, I do want to thank the department heads and the work that Brian and Richard and Buddy as well. This has really been like a fix in a puzzle, trying to move all and looking at our existing buildings, looking at some of our really bad buildings and seeing what's best to renovate, what's best not to. What there may be some tearing down of some of our older buildings once we get into it. But our department has been very, very flexible in working with us and trying to make this move. And I do want to thank you know, all their work as well and their understanding that long term that this is a good direction for the county to go into.
This is the Epps building we're talking about.
This is Sammy Epps Palace, and we will have a we will have a service for that, a memorial service.
Any other questions?
I'd like to point out, just for general information, with the sale of the Peak property and receiving the $3.9 million approximately, these moves were necessary because these people are being displaced.
That's correct.
So I just wanted to make sure that everybody knew that.
Yes, sir.
Do we have a motion?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thanks, sir. Mm-hmm.
Budget amendments, MJ.
Chair and council members, we were awarded more money than we asked for North Park this year. So very gracious in with the community development block grant this year. And we would like to, we have a budget amendment to have that difference in the amount. We had only budgeted for $10,000, which is what traditionally they give us, and they gave us more than that this year. So we would have a budget amendment to have that added to North Park's budget in line item 562, which is electronics. And we use that to purchase e-books, e-magazines, databases, things like that.
Any questions? Motion?
I move. Will we approve that? Thank you.
I beat you.
Okay. No, I'll second.
All in favor signify by saying aye. Thank you, MJ.
And Craig wanted me to tell you a little bit while I was up here about a program that we had this summer as part of our summer reading program. Every year, public libraries across the country have a huge summer reading program. And this year's theme was Fizz Boom Read. And we really have been looking at who our readers are. And as in looking at that, we realized that we do very little to attract the boys to come and read. And so this year, as part of our summer reading program, we had a wrestling component. And we collaborated with the Central Wrestling Federation, which is housed outside of Gibsonville. There's a school where you can go and learn to wrestle. They have all these wrestlers that go on to be big time on television and all this lovely stuff. And so we partnered with them for part of our summer reading program. And the results of that were that we had 398 males sign up for a reading record this or participate in the summer reading program over our 283 females. The kids read for a total of over 195,000 minutes because they went online and logged their minutes. And we had a press conference in May with the wrestlers, and I learned more about wrestling than I ever knew I wanted to know. You got the heels, who are the bad guys, and the baby faces, who are the good guys. And so the baby faces and I were having a press conference to announce our collaboration, and the heels broke in and said, kids don't need to learn to read. They don't think that the kids will want to participate. And so we made a bet. that if kids read over 100,000 minutes, that if they read less than 100,000 minutes, then the heel would be able to body slam me. And if they read more than 100,000 minutes, I would get to bust a move on Coach Gemini, who was the heel. And so they did read well over 100,000 minutes, and the Times News was at the big reading rumble at the end of the year. We had a reading wrestling championship belt made for our winner, a young man, his first name is Brendan, and he was so proud that he wore it to his family's reunion that night. We gave him his belt, and we have the video that is on the Times News website to share with you.
Okay. Great.
Ahead of time, and I forgot what I was supposed to do. So when you watch that video, all you hear is me laughing. But we had that at the Mako Bigelow Center because we're also trying to you know, get people at that library too. So the things that they do not teach you when you get your master's in library science.
And we almost had a workers' comp claim. But we're all good, and I appreciate MJ doing that.
Thank you, MJ. It's my understanding the sheriff tried to get in on that program and be on the tape.
We're gonna see if we can pull him in there.
He's gonna
get it.
I don't.
If you need any help, Terry, I'll be glad to help you.
Well, let's go back to department spotlight, Mr. Fire Marshal.
He's coming.
Good evening, Chairman Smith, Commissioners. I don't think I can follow what the cat just gave to us, and I will do my very best. Again, my name is Jesse Gwynn. I represent the Fire Marshal's Office tonight. I'm going to give a brief presentation about what our office does for the community and the citizens. Again, I'm going to go back right quick. We are located at 1950 Martin Street. We are located in the Family Justice Center in the basement. We are the Emergency Management Fire Marshal's Office. We are a small office, staff with 7. We are small, but we do a lot for the community. We hope this presentation will be a brief overview of the functions and responsibilities of our office. In our office, we have county management, and then it falls down to David Leonard, our fire marshal, followed by Alva Sizemore, our deputy fire marshal, John Payne, chemical planner, myself, I'm a fire inspector investigator, Janet Roberts is our office manager, Kevin Turner, he is our tier 2 clerk and planner, and this is actually his first day on the job. So he got working real well today, and Scott Rose is our safety manager. We do inspections in our office, and they are mandated by the state fire marshal's office. Once a year, we have to do hazards, daycares, foster homes, rest homes. Every 2 years we do industry and other things like that. Businesses, merchantile, and churches are on a 3-year basis. And at the bottom it says we do Alamance County Schools twice a year, usually in February and September. And the City of Burlington Fire Department actually does the schools inside the city limits of Burlington. This is the overview of the general inspection and permits we do in our office. We do a general inspection followed by a re-inspection within 30 days. We also do permits for blasting, fireworks and tents, fire alarms, sprinkler systems, fire pumps, and ABC inspections. This is an overview of our fire inspections past 3 years. As you can tell, It drastically increased from 2012 to 13, and as of September 30th, we have 1,100 inspections we have done so far. The assistance we provide to the county fire departments, during the day we provide manpower. These stations are limited with volunteers. Everybody's at work during the day, so we assist in that. In the event of a structure fire, our office does respond with our air truck. It's utilizing and filling up their SBA bottles, which are breathing bottles, where they go inside for fire suppression. Other services we do for the county fire departments, we do their ladder testing. We also test all their fire trucks. So this savings is about $7,000 a year to the county departments our office does. Calibrations of defibs in the offices. Also, stations have SCBA systems in their stations. They do not have ways to fill them up. We come and also take care of that with our air truck. And our chemical planner's budget provides absorbent to fire departments for liquid spills. This is Johnny Payne actually testing a 35-foot ladder in Hall River. You can tell the ladder is bent at a pretty good angle. When the weight comes off, we hope it comes back within, I think, 2 inches of where it's supposed to be. So this is done once a year at every fire department. This is myself at Quaker Lake. We're testing the fire trucks for Hall River. This right here shows our fire responses for structure fires and vehicle fires in the county. These are ones we actually went on and had to do a report. As you can see, in 2011, we had 26 actual fires, 24 accidental, and one was actually intentional. And then it stayed steady in numbers. And actually, last year, we had the most intentional fires we've had. We actually had 10 fires out of the 29 of 2013 were actually set fires. Also in our office, we do emergency management. And the purpose of emergency management is to protect communities by coordinating and integrating all activities necessary to build, sustain, and improve the capability to mitigate against, prepare for, respond to, and recover from threatened or actual natural disasters, active terrorism, or other man-made disasters. Our office provides resources for all emergency incidents, logistics, responders, like I said earlier, specialty equipment, and we also can contact the state to bring in special teams for chemical spills and also confinement rescues. Here are a few things actually we do in our office. Animal rescue, that's actually had to rescue a cow out of a pool. Everybody remembers the ice storm event of this year. We had to train derailment in Medley several years ago, and then we had the plane crash over at North Park. So just a few things our office is also responsible in assisting. Grants is something our office is working big on through the state. Able to purchase, get grants, it cuts down on the cost that we have to try to come up with ourselves. It did get some transfer switches for a couple of our shelters, Lambs Chapel and Graham Rick, and that's two of our primary shelters we use during any type of disaster. Our most recent grant purchase was a new 150 kW generator that we can take to shelters. This is a picture of it. Almost $44,000 that was able to get off a grant refunded to the county. In our office, John Payne is our chemical planner, and his job is to go out and work with our industry and businesses and their chemicals, making sure there's a proper list of any chemicals they have in their business that is hazardous. So if a fire department comes to a scene there, they'll know what type of chemical is in that building and what they need to do to mitigate that situation. He works directly with all county municipal businesses regarding emergency action plans. As you can see here, we do have a situation on a loading dock where they have a lot of oil outside. He helped in mitigating that situation with cleanup. And again, this is a chemical plant that goes out and gets reportable quantities during spills. Anything over so many gallons has to be reported to the state. And with that, everything gets sent to our state EM office, the EPA, or the Department of Natural Resources, depending on what protocol we need to follow at that time. Just another picture of a recent accident we had last year, that I think a combine was going down Corbett Road in the Pleasant Grove community and lost several gallons of hydraulic fluid. We went out and mitigated this. Tractor trailer accident on the interstate. Again, plenty of absorbent there on the ground to collect the fluids that did spill. Builder's discount last year. If you see on the left side, the saddle tank, a forklift driver decided he wanted to see how tough the tank was. He run the forks through the tank, and so we had diesel fuel come out, was able to collect all that. A new position in our office is Scott Rose, in the he's a new safety manager. And basically, he goes out and makes sure that all county buildings and facilities are safe for our employees to work. And that's very important now, safety and health issues. He's focused again on health and safety to make sure everything conforms with OSHA. That's the main thing nowadays, make sure they are happy. This position also helps to minimize county liability, reduce workers' compensation, sick time, and loss of productivity. On the right, we have a young lady doing fire extinguisher training. On the left, we're showing he's in the process of doing a program where you're going to put a cable going across that building where they'll connect their harnesses, so if they move left or right, they won't fall off the building. So another safety precaution we're working on right now. And that's all I have. Thank you for the opportunity to share this information. I'll be happy to answer any questions y'all do have.
Any questions?
Just have one. When you have a spill like that, and
yes, sir,
you mitigate by containing the spill, what do you do with the materials that you...
It all depends on the type of material it is. We usually call in a hazardous material company to come in. Like if you saw where the truck had the wreck on the interstate. Mm-hmm. Most of the time, the trucking companies already have contracts with hazmat companies, so they will contact them after the accident. They will come out and mitigate that and clean it up.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Any other questions? Thank you very much, and to all of the staff, we appreciate your service. David, looks like you have an excellent staff put together.
Yes, sir.
Good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Finance Officer.
Thank you. Good evening, Mr. Chairman, County Commissioners. I wanted to bring you all a financial update. It's been about 90 days since our fiscal year ended. I committed to you that you would have financial information on a timely basis, so we do have updated information concerning our fiscal year end and also the first quarter of our fiscal year 2015. I want to take just a minute and provide that information to you. I did want to say that all of our folks here in the county and our external auditors have completed their work. It's ready. The audit is ready to be submitted to the local government commission, which normally reviews what the county audits have come up with. There are two pieces of information that the auditors cannot get. They're both from the state, and they have to do with reports, certifications from the Department of Health and Human Services. One is related to a new Medicaid management information system that is supposed to help with the medical assistance program. Those figures have not been provided by the state to any county, so everybody's kind of in limbo on that. And the other one is a schedule of expenditures in federal and state awards, and that missing data is because of the new, what's called the North Carolina TRACS system program. So they're working diligently to get that information in, but it is not available yet. It does not affect our numbers in the general fund that you'll be reviewing, and we do not anticipate any change in what you're going to see. But because they're not finalized and approved by the local government commission, I still need to gauge them and term them as preliminary. So we're going from projected figures, which is what I told you right in July, to preliminary figures, but these are not likely to change. So we're going to talk about that and in the first quarter of 2015. You'll remember from the discussion we had before on the definition of fund balances and all the different kind of fund balances, it's strictly an update on the right-hand column of what you saw for fiscal year 2013. 2014, you'll see our total fund balance has in fact gone up $5.1 million. Our original projection was $5 million, so we were pretty close. The other groups there, no surprise, is our total budget increases, they're all going to go up just a little bit. So the number that we'll be looking at is the $31.4 million, $5.1 million ahead of last year. If you take our available fund balance last year, which was $20 million, and you add the 5.1 to it, we have to subtract, again, those amounts that are restricted by state statutes. The majority of those are receivables that are due to the county. It increased by $700,000 on a year-to-year basis, resulting in our available fund balance as of June of 14 of $24.4 million. This is the number that the Local Government Commission uses to calculate our relative strength compared to where we were and other counties. So you can see we've updated the 2014 data to show the available fund balance at $24.4 million. Our net expenditures, which basically is expenditures of the county out of Fund 2, adjusted for some lease and debt payments, the total there was $125 million. So our available fund balance percentage has in fact increased from 16.5% to 19.5%. We feel pretty good about that. Actually, we feel really good about that. You may recall when we looked at this a little while ago, the average for our peer counties was in the neighborhood of about 24%. So you can see 2 years ago, at 11%, we've made a lot of progress to getting that thing to restored to where everybody likes us again. And in fact, the Local Government Commission, on a preliminary basis, and looking at the county's numbers in connection with the bond issue for the Alamance Community College, has basically indicated that these favorable trends will really help us get that done. We're scheduled to meet with the Local Government Commission on that project in either November or December, but it's interesting, the Local Government Commission group that we're meeting with has to have the audit, and the other arm of the Local Government Commission won't have it to certify it, so we're kind of stuck in the middle. Typical, well, I won't say typical state government. Don't make Dan mad. That's where we are. That's what the end of year will look like. No other surprises. Feel real good about the progress made during fiscal year 2014. So the first quarter of 2015, I will say that all the departments have been really, really conservative on their spending. We have everybody within or below budget on expenses for the first quarter, with a couple of exceptions I'm going to discuss here. Revenues are looking really, really good. It's tough to predict and project property tax collection from August to December, because that's the time when taxpayers can take advantage of what's now a 1% discount, but the true property tax is due December 31st. We'll have a much better measure of that probably by the beginning of February. So with that aside, what I can say is that the sales tax revenue for the first two actual months of the year is up $850,000. The information we get from the state on sales tax is actually a two-month delay. So you see there we have the months of July and August, totaling $4.3 million versus about $3.5 million a year ago. That's certainly a positive indicator. The other revenue change that wasn't expected is we've experienced a $325,000 decline for our ambulance fees during the first 3 months of this year versus last year. And Chuck Mancillas actually saw this before the rest of us and wanted to know why, because his volume certainly hasn't shrunk. And in fact, the company that we're using for the third-party collection, we switched to them a couple of years, NRG out of Georgia. Susan, is that right? They actually were converting to a new collection system, a new computer system, and it held things back about 30 days. So we fully expect that to catch up, but that is a negative variance on our revenue. On the expense side, the only change we've had in personnel area, we did have the number of retirees on our health insurance plan has increased from 300, there you see 322 during the first quarter. Those are on our payroll expense, resulting in an increase of about $36,000. CCOM, you all may recall that we entered into a contract with the city of Mebane to provide 9/11 services this year. So you see the increase. This is, again, the first 3 months of this year compared to the first 3 months of last year, increase of $51,000. However, the revenue for that is going to come back through the contract we have with the city of Mebane. So that is not particularly alarming. We've talked in here before about the DOJ legal expenses. Just for the first 3 months of this quarter versus the first 3 months of last quarter, they're $38,000 ahead. But again, we've had the discussion on kind of where that stands today. The biggest area of change has been in the Department of Social Services, and those expenses have increased $928,000 this quarter compared to the quarter last year. The operating revenues and expenses are all within budget. However, the expenses associated with a couple of programs that they're involved in have resulted in primarily computer, temporary help, project expenses, most of which will be reimbursed at the rate of anywhere between 50 and 75%. The original DSS budget was actually, that we approved this year, was about $700,000 ahead of what it was last year. So really, the overage we're talking about there is really only a $250,000. Kelly is here from DSS and elaborated for me a little bit about NC Fast conversion in Northwoods. Kelly, can you just maybe take 30 seconds and update the group on the conversion, what NC Fast does and what Northwoods
sure.
does for all of us?
Sure.
You might want to come up here okay. so you can get on the microphone.
Good evening. I'm Kelly Inman, business officer at DSS. North Carolina has a new computer program called NC Fast, and we're in the midst of that conversion. And it has promised us that it would be new technological tools that will increase our time with families. Unfortunately, what we're experiencing right now is delays in application times and processing problems that have delayed. If you accompany that with the Medicaid applications, an onslaught of Medicaid applications that came about when the federal marketplace came into place, you can really understand why we have those volumes and why we needed temporary workers, why we've had to utilize mandatory overtime for our staff, and have virtual workers in order to meet USDA and Medicaid guidelines. The other program is Northwoods, and that is a computer program that helps our social workers have the information they need on iPads in the field so that they can complete their forms and respond quicker to family emergencies. And like Tom mentioned, we will be reimbursed 50 to 75% for those expenditures. But we're really excited that you can approve that conversion for us. It just happens to hit all in quarter one of this year. So we are having heavy expenditures right now, but we expect that to calm down. Any questions?
Any questions?
Thank you, Kelly. As I mentioned, I went through with Susan the other departments, and everybody else has been really conservative. Not that they haven't been conservative. Everyone's been very conservative in their approach to spending money during this first quarter, and it does show in the positive variances we have. So if there are any questions concerning either the preliminary fund balance results or what's happened during the first quarter of 2015, I'll be glad to refer them to Susan to answer.
Any questions for Tom? Thank you, Tom. Those figures look good to me. I think the board's done a great job planning the comeback.
Mr. Chairman, also, to you know, if you remember, we were in the top 10 or top 20 with respect to being behind on recertifications under NC Fast. We are greatly on track to be where we need and to be back getting our recertifications done. So they've done a wonderful job using technology, also using temporary workers to get us to the level that we need to be. So recertifications are not taking 30 and 60 and 90 days. So we're getting back where we need to be. So that's a big hand to DSS for that work.
And I would point out that our revenues are also up $586,000 for the same time period. So do remember that DSS is an agency that we have to counterbalance those revenue figures. So it's not as bad as it looks.
That's good.
Thank you, Kelly. Anything else from the manager?
I do have three or four things, Mr. Chairman. First, I would like to ask Stacy Saunders, who is our health director, to come forward and kind of really give us an update on the county's response to the Ebola scare and what the county is doing, working with our local partners in trying to be as prepared as we can be in case something does happen.
Director. So good evening. I get the honor to tell you about Ebola. So I thought I would start this off with just a summary of what we're seeing both in West Africa and in the U.S. and then go into what our local response has been. and then if you have any questions after that. So just a summary, according to the CDC, and this has been updated as of October 15th, so there's a little bit of a delay in getting the numbers, but according to the October 15th numbers, there are total cases of 8,997 with total deaths of 4,493. The vast majority of those cases and those deaths have been in West Africa, primarily in three countries, Sierra Leone, Guinea, and Liberia, with smaller outbreaks in both Nigeria and Senegal, but those two countries have not seen any cases since September 5th and August 29th, respectively. We also have seen two travel-related or travel-associated cases, one in Spain and one in the U.S. You all are probably very familiar with the one in the U.S. That travel-associated Ebola case was diagnosed on September 30th, and that was an individual who traveled from Liberia to the U.S. And presented to the Texas Presbyterian Hospital. Mr. Duncan, you all are probably familiar with that in the news. Presented on September 24th and was not admitted, and then presented on the 26th to the hospital and was admitted at that time. That individual later died, unfortunately. So from that index case, or that initial case in Dallas, Texas, there were two local transmitted cases, both to healthcare workers, the first being on October 10th and the second on October 14th. At the time of the initial individual, Mr. Duncan, there were 48 contacts placed under active monitoring, which is the active surveillance done in the public health part of it. And I can happily say that as of today, those folks have come off of their active monitoring because they've completed 21 days without symptoms and no longer are at risk. And now I'll switch to just to tell you a little bit about what's happening on the local level. So just so everyone knows, there are no cases in North Carolina. The North Carolina Division of Public Health has been preparing since July, August, and we have as well. And so at the same time, we at the local health department began meetings as an EPI team, and an EPI team is required in each one of the counties of North Carolina, and that's a team that works for any communicable disease or infectious disease that happens in a county. And so we began with our EPI team and began regular EPI team meetings and participating in statewide weekly calls. So every county in the state was participating in those calls. At that time, we disseminated letters to local missionary groups and faith-based organizations as a contact to say, if you have anybody going to those areas or coming back, please let us know. We also contacted our local university, Alamance University, for any study abroad that they may have, and at that time we found none at that time. So we then transitioned from just an EPI team, which is more of a localized, really health department-centered team, to the Incident Command System, ICS for short, where we brought in lots of our community partners who are working on their own protocols if we were to ever see a case of Ebola here. So we brought in our not only our health department staff, but ARMC, Moses Cone, first responders, EMS, and emergency management to start off with. And in this structure, if you're familiar with Incident Command, in this structure, each agency and individual has a role, and we share responsibilities, and everyone has a role in the event that we have a case. And so just to lay out some of the basics of what the roles are for the health department and for emergency management, which you got to see tonight as part of the fire marshal's office, we're charged with planning and preparedness, and then our hospitals are charged with the medical management piece. So if we were to ever have a case, the hospital would obviously be in charge of caring for the patient. And then also we're charged with sharing guidance with partners, creating protocols, facilitating training for our own staff and for staff out in the community that may be part of the incident command, setting up a command center where all that communication happens in one place, and outreach to specific groups. In addition, the local health department is also charged with the active monitoring. If we were ever have a case here in Alamance County, that case would obviously have some contacts, and we would be charged with making sure and doing surveillance on those contacts, doing the surveillance, the prevention and infection control, and notifying the hospital, the Division of Public Health, and EMS of any changes in their condition during that 21 days of monitoring. So I'll stop and ask any if you have any questions now, because that was sort of a lot of information at once.
Heard on the news that there may be now a 38-day monitoring period versus 21 days. Is that fact, fiction, or do you know anything about that?
I think what you're referring to is the 48 days, and what that is that, so 21 days is the time in which we monitor someone, because symptoms for Ebola, on average, will present somewhere between 8 and 10 days, but can be as few as 2 and as many as 21. The 48 days piece is particularly for outbreaks in countries. So Senegal has now come off of the list because they've completed 2 cycles, so one 21-day cycle and a second 21-day cycle. And so that allows them to come off of that list at that time, that they are now outbreak-free. I think that might be what you're referring to.
And second thing, you've been very, very good at keeping us up to date. I really appreciate that.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
Any other questions? Thank you, Director.
So if I could just, before I go, if I could just sort of, I know that folks watch this on video, if I could give out the 1-800 number in case folks want to have questions about Ebola, they can call 1-800-222-1222. Again, that's 1-800-222-1222. But you are always welcome to call the health department as well. We are there to help answer those questions. And while I get to be the one to present to you, there are lots of talented folks who work with me on this. And some of those, and to give special thanks to those, are that my staff at the health department, also ARMC, Moses Cohn, EMS, CCOM, first responders, and emergency management. I can't say enough about the preparedness talent that they have. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
And Brian and I are starting to go to those meetings as well, and we just amazed at the level of talent and a level of concern and professionalism that are in these meetings, and know that we're in very good hands. So
thank you.
Anything else?
Yeah, I'm afraid I do. A couple of other things. I did want to give you an update on the 9/11 piece that was presented to the board. One of the discussions that the board had was to work with municipalities to get them to help fund the piece. And Brian and I met with the municipal managers, but we also invited the fire chiefs and the police chiefs to be a part of the presentation from Casey, and it went really, really well. They liked it, loved the concept. They think that maybe the possibility of the rotunda at the courthouse is a great location. We asked them about fundraising, if they'd be willing to help fundraise. They politely said no, and the reasoning for that was with the Fallen Heroes Memorial that was just completed, they are kind of fundraisered out. But the good news is the municipalities did say that they would be willing to contribute to the piece. So if the board is agreeable, we thought about it as a $10,000 cost for the statue, is if the county would put $5,000 in and then we would go to the municipalities for the other half. And then by getting that approved now, hopefully we can have the unveiling at the next September 11th anniversary.
If
the board's approved.
Everybody in favor?
Yeah.
And I'll go and go to the other boards or municipalities and ask them for that money, and we'll get that taken care of. Okay. But we'll go ahead and also commission that with Casey as well. The next thing I did want to mention is we had a meeting with the Hallfields Economic Development Board. The municipalities of Mevin and Graham and myself, we're going to have another meeting with the property owners that right now is scheduled for November 13th from 3 to 5 p.m. at the Mevin City Hall, more of a drop-in type meeting. One of the things that came out of this meeting was marketing. Did this need to become a certified site? What do we need as far as small area plans? And there's some costs that are involved in that. You know, first we wanted to bring it to the citizens to see if they were supportive of what we wanted to do. And if they were supportive, once we get their input, we're going to bring it back to all three boards for final approval, and it would be a third cost share for each board. I don't have a number on that yet, but we wanted to bring that to the property owners first and make sure they had that buy-in. And again, that'll be November 13th from 3 to 5 p.m. at Mevin City Hall. Any questions on that?
Question.
Next is a couple well, a bunch of dates that you may want to put on your calendar. It is calendar time. Tomorrow, October 21st at 4 p.m., Grand Civic Center, which is on McGee Street, is the Enrique Kiki Camarena Award, which the Sheriff's Department and the municipalities have nominated an officer to receive this award. Is that okay? I wanted to make sure I got that right. But they've invited Board of Commissioners and also the municipal boards as well. So that's tomorrow, 4 p.m. at the Graham Civic Center. October 21st, which is tomorrow as well, at 7 p.m. is the Political Appreciation Night by the Alamance Castle Builders Association. And that will be at Select Bank on South Worth Street in Burlington, from 5:30 to 7. Then next, October 29th, is the City County Dinner, which will be held by or hosted by ABSS, and that will be at their Vaughn Road Library or Central Office on Vaughn Road, beginning at 6.
And when is that?
October 29th. We do have our Veterans Day Parade at November 11th. At 1 p.m. is the start time. Again, if you're interested in riding, please see Miss Brenda Perry, and she'll make sure you get the car. I think I'm driving a Lexus, so I'm very excited. But that's November 11th. November 12th, the Sheets Grand Opening. And that is stated to begin at 11:30 a.m. And again, that's the new distribution center off of White's Kennel Road. And then we'll jump to December 3rd, the Alamance Community College Public Officials Breakfast will begin at 7:30 that morning. Also, immediately following that, we will have our Employee Service Awards here in this room. So that'll probably start around 9 o'clock.
And the Honda Aero has a celebration or something the same day as the Sheets. In fact, it's right before the Sheets.
I have not seen that. I'm sorry. I'll get a check on that.
I don't
know. I don't think I did
either.
Yeah,
that's right.
You got
they're 11:30.
And Tori, you've got the card on that. Yeah.
We have the times.
Okay. All right. And that is all I have. I can make up some more stuff if you like. So.
Craig, let me suggest that you get with Pam and follow up on her request.
We will.
Okay, Pam? Commissioner's comments? John, I think you have.
Yes, sir. Mr. Honeycutt, would you please come up here and help me just a second? This is a little heavy, and I want you to hold it for me if you will. Craig Honeycutt, this past Wednesday, was awarded, and if you'll turn around and show that to everyone. This is the Randall L. Billings Public Service Award that was awarded at the Piedmont Triad Regional Council meeting this past week. This is for outstanding service, and he is one of three people that were recognized and received this award. We just want to say thank you for your, and part of this was because of bringing in Walmart, only 450 jobs. 450 jobs,
yeah.
And $90 million in investment. Way to go. Thank you.
I do want to say that has probably been as fun a project to work on if it wasn't for the attorneys that were involved. Clive had a huge hand in it. Charles Bateman with the city mayor, Mr. Keith Whitehead, the managers in Graham and Mevin also received the same award, but But again, that was a fun project. There were no egos involved, and it really was, what can we do best for Alamance County? And it really worked out well. So, but again, if it wasn't for this board having the support and really saying, we support this fully, just go get it done, it wouldn't have happened as well. So I applaud y'all as well for having that leadership. So thank you.
I would encourage you to come look at the clock. It's impressive, and shake his hand.
Thank you, Craig, and congratulations.
Oh, thank you.
Thank all of you for coming this evening. It's we've had a great audience tonight, and no unheard of disturbances. Is there a motion to adjourn?
Before you do that, you didn't even throw anybody out tonight.
Sorry.
Go
ahead, John. You have the floor.
Well, I just said the chairman did not throw anybody out tonight. I just want to say thanks.
Is there a motion to adjourn?
Second.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building, located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m., and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel, beginning at 10 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of the commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information on the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.